Each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one, but not alone. My finest day is yet unknown. I broke my heart for every gain to taste the sweet. I faced the pain. I rise and fall, yet through it all, this much remains. I want one moment in time when I'm more than I thought I could be, when all I've lived to be the very best, and I want it all. No time for less. I've laid my plans, now laid a chance here in my hands. Give me
our role support CCF is we are here on the retail side to make sure that we are raising as much funds, you know, to go towards the family with the children with life limiting conditions to make a difference to that family. Also we raise awareness, telling all the customers who ask what the charity is about. A lot of people ask about the boys and the families that we support, so it's really, really endearing to know that people, not just in South Shields but Tyneside, all over, that they want to know what the Charlie and Carter Foundation is all about.
So much strain on the families at that time in their life. It's like a really dark time, and it makes you feel proud to be able to take that, at least that financial strain off them, and giving that phone call is just really inspiring to see how much relief that gives them.
Part of this job, there is that sad element where, you know, you come into work one day and there is that somber feeling that there isn't something quite right, and then you learn that one of the family's children have passed away. It really is, you know, it gets you right in the heart, because then you know the work you do and day in, day out, to make that, you know, that money to support them families, it does make a difference, you know, in that hour of need.
My main role at CCF is managing the families. The applications come to me from start to finish. I contact the families and I work with them throughout the whole process to make sure they're always up to date, getting all the information together for the trustees so that the applications can go through complete. When I get to let a family know that they've been successful, it's an amazing feeling. Whether it's a phone call or an email, it's just absolutely overwhelming knowing that I get to tell them that, you know, the good news that they're gonna have a little bit of financial relief and that we're gonna support them, and it's just amazing. And hearing them and hearing the pause and then the relief and then just the reaction, there's just no feeling like it. It's definitely the best part of my job. But recently I had the opportunity and the pleasure and absolute honour to go and meet one of our families, our most recent family, Reggie. and being able to sit face to face and have a conversation and let them know that they've been successful was just absolutely amazing. To see them and to meet Reggie and put faces to names and give them a hug, it was just the best feeling in the world.
Hi everybody, we are the girls from the Morgan. So there's only three of us here because the other two. This is Josie. This is Linda.
Yeah.
Wave to the camera.
To the camera.
Yes, and we are there every Friday.
I'm motivated by the fact that not only do we help an amazing charity, we're helping a lot of people out there, maybe on low incomes, who can't afford lots of things, and they look forward to coming and seeing our store because they know they're getting a lot of good quality stuff.
I'm so proud to be part of this charity. It's the best thing I've ever done. We've got very, very loyal customers. Even if they don't buy anything off the stall, they still give money. And they'll say it, we'll just put that in because
we couldn't do what we do without all the great donations we get on a daily basis. We're absolutely rammed in the shop, on the market. I don't care where it comes from. People keep coming. They come from miles, and I mean miles. Even North Shields, that's miles. But they come every Friday. And what happens then? Every penny we raise goes to the lovely families that we help, whom nobody else knows about half the time. And I didn't realise this. And we couldn't do a Friday without a driver. Chris came, he's been here just over a year, I think. And honestly, he started at the beginning. And bless him, he hadn't a clue. But now he's great.
Even people come to the market, they may bring a little bag of books in or a little few clothes in, but to them they're helping us, and to us they're all helping, which are to help all these families that need help, that have to have time off work, that children are dying, things like that. It's absolutely amazing charity.
Right, over the year we run a number of different events. We've got our regular events which we do for the boys, which is the Great North Run, our trek from the Stadium of Light to St James's Park, Wear Blue for the boys, a number of events which we try to do every year. But we also do a lot of independent events, like I mentioned earlier. People will approach us and ask if they can raise funds for us, and people have got many different ideas. It can be a cake sale, it could be a jumble sale, it can be a raffle. We've got supporters who do crazy things like run 5 marathons a day, or like Andy, who's going to run from one end of the country to another. We welcome any kind of idea. We just bring it on, the more the better for us.
Got to say that I'm really proud of my role within the charity. The families that we support are my motivation, they're my inspiration to get up and come to work every day. I enjoy coming to work because I know the work that I do is going to change lives. Families we support have only got a short time together, and the fact that I can help them families, you know, have quality time in the short time that they've got, it's, who wouldn't be rewarded by that? And you are affected by the work that we do. At the end of the day, we're supporting families with children with life-limiting conditions. Ultimately, those children are going to die. And I think what's affected me most is when we receive the phone calls from the nurse, the health visitor, the social worker, letting us know that one of our CCF families is no longer with us. It's quite bittersweet. You're quite proud that you've supported the family and that you have helped them. But the fact that that child is no longer with us, it's just heartbreaking. Life's cruel. Children have got their whole lives ahead of them. To think that these things happen in the world, it's just, you know, but like I say, the fact that we're part of that family's life for a short period of time and have actually made a difference for the better, I'm proud of that, but it does affect you on a daily basis. It is, it's really heartbreaking.
When Chris asked me to do a small video as to why we set the charity up, and I've decided to just record my voice and let you look at the pictures that mean the most to me, the most precious things in my life, who I still feel like they're still by my side, is my boys. The reason why we set the Charlie Cookson Foundation up back in 2013 was, we witnessed 2.5 years of families like us suffering, living every day in and out of hospital, And just facing a fear every day that today could be the day that they lose the child. Without any doubt, these children who are poorly and who are suffering a life-limiting condition would not live as long as life would they have or they are if it wasn't for their mammy and daddy, or just their mammy or just their daddy. These parents basically are the lifeline of these children, and without them, they just would not survive. Along with this worry of caring for your sick child is the worry of how on earth are we going to keep our home, how on earth are we going to eat, how are we going to sleep, because we're gone, because of the worry and because of the stress of looking after your child whose machine is constantly beeping through the night. These families needed financial support as well as emotional support, just to get them through each day. We would rather have this family together in a hospital room caring for the child rather than feeling that they had to go to work to keep a roof above their head. So that's why we set up the Charlie Cookson Foundation, to relieve the financial strain that they suffer immensely caring for the sick child.
It took us 5 years to try again. I think what we went through, we established the charity. We got ourselves in a partly better place after losing Charlie, and we were ready to try again. And after 5 years, we finally got in that position to say, you know, let's try it. We couldn't have been happier when we first found out. Scans were fine. Sarah was growing. Things were looking really, really positive. We had the hope. We had the hope that everything was going to be fine this time.
So we decided to try and be a family again, which was no easy decision at all. We were over the moon at the reveal day when we found out it was going to be another boy. I knew without any doubt it would be the spit of his brother. Every appointment, every test, I can't tell you how worried I was, but maybe me, I headed very well.
It was on the 37-week scan, and they had a concern that something was not quite right about his weight. So Christmas Eve they kept Sarah in, but I thought, you know, it's going to be a nice Christmas present. Carter's going to come early, and that's what we thought. We thought he was just going to come out a couple of weeks early and everything was going to be great.
We had the most amazing team running and sort of driving forward the charity. Still the Charlie Cookson Foundation, they had so much passion for it, and we knew that it was in good hands. There was complications with the C-section. The general anaesthetic didn't work, so I had to be fully intubated and sent to sleep to give birth to Carter.
And at 12:20, I remember hearing him come into this world, and I remember putting my ear against the delivery room wall just to try and hear a little bit more. And at 2:30, I had my first cuddle.
At approximately 12 p.m. on Boxing Day, I have no memory whatsoever due to the medication of my little boy without a tube.
And I remember talking to Carter. I remember saying, you know, we're gonna get tattoos, and we're gonna get motorbikes, and I remember telling him that he was going to be all right because his big brother was going to look after him. And I remember we washed his hair and we changed his nappy, and we had hope, but something was not right. And it was a really scary time, and it was bringing back memories of Charlie. We still didn't want to believe it, and we still thought, no, this time it's going to be all right. And then 10:30, I was in a different room with a different view of my boy.
I felt like I'd woke up out of surgery and I'd woke up in hell. I couldn't understand why this was happening again. Couldn't understand why I was looking at my second born with all these tubes, who was the spit of his brother. And again, not knowing why he was in this way. They only knew there was something wrong with his heart.
We needed a heart transplant, and there was nothing else was going to save his life. Remember, we did everything we could with the press, with the media, hoping somebody was going to hear our plea. On the Friday night, on the 18th, I remember leaving his room, and me and Sarah walked from the ward to where we were staying. And I always remember, because we didn't say nothing, because we knew something was wrong. We both didn't want to speak about it. And on the Saturday morning at 8:30, we got a phone call from a big media source, and they wanted to go live. But we knew that was the last day we were going to be a family, and it's the only time we turned down a press coverage, because we knew it was too late. We started reading the book to Carter in hospital. It was 100-odd pages long. Remember on that Saturday, we were on page 22, and we finished that book. Read all 100 pages. We kissed them goodnight the last time. That was the only thing we were able to do. Our son. In 1845, on 19th of January, he lost that fight.
He was so brave, and I think, just like his big brother, he had the strength of an absolute lion. Looking at him fighting every single day until his little body just could not take any more. I just had so much admiration, so much love for him. Unbelievably proud of both our boys. Without any doubt, our boys were here for a reason. I have no idea why me and Chris were chosen, but I think it's the courage and the strength that they've given to us, that they would know that we would do all we can to help little boys and girls just like Charlie, and little boys and girls and babies just like Carter. They all need something. Charlie needed his mummy and daddy, and we did everything that we could to make sure that they can be there with them, and that the financial strain that they don't feel every day stops them from being their lifeline. Carter needs us to talk about the importance of organ donation, and that everybody has the gift of life, and then the only way I can think of it is it's not two lives that go, it's one life, and part of that life that's gone stays on in that other person, and that is the most amazing gift anybody can give.
I've been roaming.